Hi, this is Jaimie. I want to take you through a couple of charts here, and particularly I want to look at how we can see some anomalies in some of this data and what it means, and how we can also connect different charts between each other, so that the idea being is when you get a look at different things in different charts, if you can connect them, then you'll get a much clearer piece of insight into what's going on. What I've got here is a young elite swimmer. And what we're looking at, as you can see, are two laps of a 25 meter pool. So we're talking about a 50 meter swim. And just to start with, we've got a little bit more force being pushed through the left hand and the orange than it is through the right hand. But where we want to go to is in his force field. Now, his force field doesn't look too bad when we're looking at both hands combined. So we've got propulsion of just on almost 50%. But we've got a big chunk of downward force going there at almost 40% downward. So let's try and understand where that's coming from and the best way to try and transfer some of that downward to propulsive. And so the first thing we want to do is look at each hand on their own. So if we turn the left hand off, what we see is the propulsion shoots up to almost 65%. And the downward drops right down to 22. Then if we turn the right off and look at the left, now what we see is the left is right down at 33. So that left hand percentage is almost half as propulsive as the right hand in terms of time and energy that it's spending in the propulsive phase, because he's getting up near 60% of his energy on his left hand is pushing downward. So instantly we can see a mismatch, if you like, between the left and the right in terms of the technique. Now, this might be breathing related. Whatever it is, this needs to be highlighted so that the swimmer and the swimmer's coach can be working on exactly this. And how do we get this left hand performing more like the right hand? Because if that left hand is going at 64%, then understandably his combined propulsion will go from 49 to 64%, which is a huge change. So we've identified the differential. We've identified that it appears to be in the downward as opposed to lateral. So what we should be looking at now is let's look at his force versus time. Now, a lot of people get a little bit nervous when they look at this chart because they think, oh, this is a bit too scientific for me. It's not. And if you don't know how to read it, I'll show you very quickly. It'll take 2 seconds. And for the purpose of this, to make it a bit easier, we're going to turn off his left hand and we'll just look at his right hand. And just so that we can get some clarity, I'm going to put the different vectors up there together. And the reason is so that we can clearly see the recovery phase. And the recovery phase is when the hand's out of the water. And when the hand is out of the water, it's going to register zero on the force sensor. So you can see right here is where the hand is exiting after this stroke. The hand exits the water here, and then the hand enters the water here for the glide of the following stroke. Same story here, exit, entry, exit, entry. So you can see it's very easy to identify where those three phases are. And the glide goes from here to here, and then this blue is his propulsive phase, so you can see he's starting to pull. So recovery, glide, pull, exit. Recovery, glide, pull, exit, and so on. Nice and simple. Now, let's have a look at this. We'll go back to both hands. And what we're seeing here is what we call a double peak. So if we look at his propulsion here, we'll just pick out his right hand. You can see these double peaks going on in his propulsive phase. That means that he's being propulsive, he's hitting a nice peak of propulsion here, then something's going on and he's suddenly losing that propulsion, and then something happens again and he finds it and then he exits and the cycle repeats. As you can see, up, down, double peak. Obviously, we don't want to be losing that propulsion halfway through our stroke. How do we find it? So Let's look at his lateral in combination. Now, this is gets pretty interesting for me. And what do we see here is we see a pattern. Now, to read the lateral force is very simple. When we are in positive numbers, i.e. when this lateral curve is above the x-axis or above zero, that says that that hand is facing outwards. And where it comes in below zero or into negative, the hand is facing inwards. And this is the same for left and right. So where it's positive, the hand is facing outwards, and where it's negative, the hand's facing inwards. And if we switch on the left as well, if we just to show you when we do it here, you'll see here the left is primarily going inwards, except this little bit of outwards at the back end of the stroke here and here. But the right hand here, I think this is his breakout. Yeah, this is his breakout. And as he's breaking out, that hand is definitely facing outwards. Now, it might be pushing out, or it might just be facing out as he's starting to pull. But either way, that's out, and then it comes in. So we'll turn the left off again, and we'll just come back and look at his right. And I think you'll find some interesting stuff. The first thing I see is the correlation at the point between the correlation between what his lateral forces are at the point where his propulsion is falling off the cliff. So let's look at here. Here, the hand is facing outwards and there's creating outward force. And then right there, you can see it turns. And so literally that hand has done that. And now it's creating inward force. And right at that point is where in his, and this is the breakout, remember, this is his breakout stroke. That propulsive force drops down a bit, then it goes back up. And then look here, where it drops off here, that hand has gone back the other way. Yeah, so you've got a hand rotation here and a hand rotation here. Now let's look at his first stroke. Exactly the same story here. And you've got this bottoming out and then it changes here. And then likewise there. Here, same story. You've got these patterns going on all the way through where you've got this replication going on between what his hand is doing rotation-wise and how it's then dropping off the cliff with propulsion. Isn't that fascinating? Now, let's have a look at his left hand. Now, the left hand, as I said before, doesn't appear to have an outward-facing component. I'll swap hands. Doesn't appear to have the outward-facing component. It tends to be primarily facing in and getting inward force coming in here. But you can see right here, similar patterns going on his left hand, where that hand angle changing here and it dropping off a bit there. Same story here. So we've definitely got a pattern going on with his hands rotating, that's affecting his propulsion. That's clear. Now, what we should do is we should look at his downward force, because remember, if we go back to the force field, it's his downward force in his left hand. Sorry, his right hand is 22, which is why he's been able to be 60, over 64, almost 65% propulsive. But when we go to his left, his propulsion drops right down to 33 because he's generating almost 60% on his left hand in pushing down. So we'll go back to the force versus time, and then let's look at his vertical. Now, instantly, you can see here the comparison between the purple is his right hand downward force in here, and you can see the small amount that he's generating in here versus look at this amount that he's generating on his left hand. It's huge in comparison. So what we're looking for here is how do we, and we'll, in fact, we'll do the right first of all, and we'll show what really good looks like. So really good looks like a lot of propulsion in that stroke and only a little bit of downward there, 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 and there versus the left hand where you can see the amount of downward force that he's generating is equal to or at sometimes exceeding what is his peak propulsion. So this is a great opportunity for this swimmer to work on how he can get that into that. And it won't be because this is a sprinter. It won't be because he's going to have a high elbow catch, but it'll be in that technique and how we can transition. Because obviously he's doing it with his right hand. He can do it with his left. One other thing that I'll show you whilst we're here, this just sort of gives you a bit of an idea of the data itself. So T equals zero right there. That's where his hands enter the water, and you can see it starts to measure the data here. And this is stream lengthening. So zero through to here is dolphin kicking. So I think he drops in feet first, pushes off the wall, and then dolphin kicking and streamlining through here, and then he goes into his breakouts. I'll turn the vertical off. And then he goes into the breakouts here. One other thing that will be cool just to show you is if I can click on this, and what we've got is we've actually got the video, because we collected his, this was done in a camp up in Brisbane, and we're able to collect video and synchronize his video with his swim. And if I right click on that and open picture in picture, this will give us a blown up view of what's going on. Now you can see that when we do the video, we capture the flash on his handset. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start playing, turn the volume off. So we've captured that flash because that becomes the point of synchronization. You can see this red line moving. That red line is moving and capturing data, but because he's out of the water, it's not getting any measurement. But you'll see right here is where he drops in the water. And you'll see as it comes up and as it approaches, you'll see he goes, here he comes, bing, and he gets ready for the push-off. And that's what I was saying before. If I blow this lap one up, you can see here, this is the push-off that's happening right here. And then here are his dolphin kicks, and then he goes into his breakout. So the beauty about this system is not only can we see this sort of stuff, but we can look at it. In fact, let's turn the left off. Let's just focus on his right. Let's focus on lap one. As you can see, we've got his two laps here. So this is lap one. And here's this double peak that he's got. Let's have a look, and we can click here. We can click right there, and don't make a fool of me. Bingo. And you'll see that that takes us to that frame in the video of exactly what's going on. And we can click this button here, forward and backward. And unfortunately, we're filming from the side because the coaches wanted to see particularly what's going on with his hips. I like, when we're talking about looking at those lateral phases or rotations, I like to get the video from the front so you can see exactly what that hand is doing as it comes through. But you can see on the video, I'll just take that off, you can see that back of the hand there. You can see the straps on the back of his hand where his hand is turned in. And that's why he's lost that propulsive force here. And you can then continue to go through frame by frame, and you can see exactly where you are on the data with the red line, and you can see in the video where the hand is now going to exit the water, which is right here where it's exiting. Likewise, I want to have a look at his left. What we can do, we'll blow up lap two, and we'll just click on here and say, let's show us lap two. Now we can see his left hand, and we can see what's going on at any stage, backwards and forwards, and you can find that frame and go frame by frame. So as well, if we want, we can look at his lateral on here too. We can put multiple vectors, and we can see where he's, what he's doing here. And right here, he's actually generating inward force right there in this valley of propulsion, which again, you can see that hand there. You can see the back of the hand as it's angled in, where he's generating that lateral force inwards. So hopefully that's enough to show you how to see things in his data. Also how cool this can be when you marry it up with video, how easy it is to synchronize, which I'll go back to here and just move that just to show back to T minus zero. Capturing one handset, the flash on the handset, and then there are instructions as to how to sync it. It's very, very simple. It's just a matter of finding the first frame where the light goes out, and then you hit the button on the screen here, which says mark, start and save, and happy days. Thanks for your attention. Hope you got something out of this. See you later.